Hello, my name's Jack Raymond, and I'm a lead algorithms researcher in the performance research group at D-Wave Systems. Thanks, Andrew, for the great talk. I apologize, this talk is starting a few minutes late if you're on the live feed, but those extra minutes really helped me to acclimatize to the environment here and fully relax. So today, I'm talking about results with the Advantage processor. Last year that was launched, it has over 5,000 qubits. So if we're lucky, we can study optimization problems with over 5,000 variables. But unfortunately, 5,000 variables is not big enough. So we have to use hybrid methods if we want to go beyond that and try to use the power of the processor. So I'll try and show how we can use the power of our quantum processors in hybrid workflows. I'll do this with an open source method using the D-Wave hybrid framework. And I'll do it specifically for some lattice structured problems. So the algorithm I'll show is a simple greedy method where the QPU does almost all the work, the quantum processing unit that is. I'll show how with this workflow, we've shown major advances from the D-Wave 2000 Q processor to the Advantage processor. I'll show the importance of embeddings, and I'll also compare against some of the competitor methods, such as simulated annealing, which are well suited to the class of problems I'm going to present in this talk. So everyone here knows a little bit about quantum annealing. In this talk, the quantum processing unit is going to be used as an annealer in a standard workflow. So in this workflow, we have a binary quadratic model or an Ising model as shown mathematically here. We're going to prepare the wave function in a uniform superposition and then gradually turn on the energy landscape associated with this optimization problem. At the end of the anneal, in the middle of the anneal, we search the landscape via quantum fluctuations, which are gradually removed. And then at the end of the anneal, we decohere in a classical state, which can be measured as an approximation to the ground state. So we can do this for problems that are structured like our processor, Pegasus problems, with over 5,000 variables. But we're not restricted to Pegasus structured problems, because we can minor embed. So in minor embedding, we take one variable and we represent it not by one qubit, but by several qubits. And those several qubits can collectively represent more interesting connectivity patterns in the processor, while still behaving like a two-state object towards the end of the anneal. So we can anneal these objects and use them as logical spins. So we've made quite big advances from D-Wave 2000Q to Advantage in terms of the scale of problems we can embed. Two cases are shown, the fully connected problem and a cubic lattice problem. The cubic lattice problem turns out to be particularly favorable because we can use only two qubits per variable, and this allows us to study relatively large problems. And the connectivity pattern is also very regular. So we've shown gains in the performance over cubic lattices as shown in the cited paper. So we can do cubic lattices, but we're still restricted in size. So how do we go beyond the scale we can study 15 by 15 by 12 in the case of Advantage processors? So I'm showing here one workflow which was proposed by Okada-san and colleagues several years ago when they had access to a D-Wave 2000Q processor. So in this case, they look at a cubic lattice which is bigger than the maximum scale, which can be studied directly on that processor. And they break it up into subproblems. So they'll find a subproblem using a generic graph embedding, which is limited to few variables, and optimize this subregion, post-process the result and substitute back in. Or as they proposed, you can use a heuristic embedding to find a larger subregion and use the same flow there. So you solve this subregion, substitute the result back in and post-process, and iterate either of these two flows. So the flow I'm going to show today is very similar to this, and it's been proposed several times independently by different researchers. And this will be similar to this flow, except instead of using a heuristic embedding or a generic graph embedding, we're going to use an embedding that's specific for cubic lattice and is optimal, the embedding shown in the previously cited paper. And we also find that there's no need to do any post-processing of samples. For the minority of cases where these logical qubits are broken, so-called chain breaks, we can just assign them randomly, assign those states at random. Okay, so I'll show this second visualization of this process, which may be easier to understand. We have a problem which, in this case, is a square grid. And our subsolver is maybe restricted to 4x4 blocks. So we initially assign the states plus minus one at random, represented by red and blue. And then we take our subsolver, we find a subregion. We assume the boundary is correct, which conditions the problem over the subregion, and applies external fields on these boundary spins. We then submit this problem to the subsolver, which is going to be the QPU in our case. We get the optimal result back, and we resubstitute. Okay, so now we've improved the estimate over this region. We then select the new region and repeat the process. And we can iterate this until we've updated all the spins or reached some timeout criteria or otherwise converged. And then we arrive at an estimate for the ground state. So the work I'm going to show today is related to a cubic lattice target problem. So we can study 15x15x12 cubic problems on Advantage directly. So to challenge the processor, we'll try and study something that's twice the volume, so 18x18x18. And I'll consider specifically spin glass problems as the major subject. So in a spin glass problem, you have couplings assigned plus or minus one at random, which leads to a frustrated problem with a very rich energy landscape. And I'll also consider two other cases, one of which is a ferromagnetic cubic lattice problem, which is a much easier problem with no frustration. And I'll also consider a Pegasus structured spin glass problem where chain length is one, and this is our highest performing case in this presentation. And I'll do all of this using the D-Wave hybrid framework, which is part of the Ocean software development kit. To make this lattice specific solver work, we've open sourced two new components in this library. One of them is a method for encoding these embeddings called make origin embeddings. And the other component is a sublattice decomposer, which is a method to take this embedding and extract a random subproblem from the lattice. And relative to what was offered previously in D-Wave hybrid, this is a lattice-specific workflow, so it works specifically for these lattice problems like the cubic lattice spin glass. And the other piece of information we have to provide is an optimal embedding, which can come, for example, from the cited paper, or a couple of other embeddings are also included in this open source library. So I'll show the code in Python, which I hope will be easy enough to follow even for non-Python coders. So the first thing we can do is set up our subsolver, which is the QPU. We specify the lattice dimensions and then the solver we want to use, which in this case is the online Advantage processor. With the update available now, this processor uses an extended H-range from minus 4 to 4, which is quite beneficial to this application. The other special things we do are we turn autoscale off. And this is to make use of extended J range and set chain strength to 2. The annealing time and the number of reads are adjusted to make good use of QPU access time. We can then initialize our state. And then we can, from these components, we can define our workflow. And our workflow involves selecting a subregion with this new decomposer component, submitting to the QPU with the fixed embedding, and then just substituting that solution back into the current estimate. So once we have this single iteration definition, we can just loop it. So we can put it into a loop function and say, do this repeatedly until we reach a timeout. There's also a track min component in here. So what we'll do is if the suggested move is not an energy improvement, we'll reject it. So this turns the algorithm into a greedy algorithm. And we can go, this simple workflow is the one I'll present results for today, but we can go beyond it in this framework. So we can consider, for example, in parallel to the QPU branch running, we can have a classical branch. This could, for example, be a steepest descent solver, which is going to, in effect, do parallel processing of our sample while the QPU is working. And because this greedy descent can finish before the QPU returns the result, it basically has no impact on latency. So we can create two parallel branches, one of which is the QPU and one of which is the classical branch, run them in parallel and merge the results. In this case, I just use an argmin merge, so we take the best of the two results. We can also compare against more powerful classical solvers. In this example, I'm showing Taboo. We can run a Taboo algorithm in parallel with the QPU. When the QPU returns its result, the Taboo search method is halted. And we can again merge the results. And I've shown here an example of greedy path merge, which is a path relinking algorithm that completes relatively fast and chooses the best compromise between the solution found by the QPU branch and the classical branch. So I'll move on to results. And first, I'll show a comparison with a result from the paper by Okada-san and colleagues. In this example, they're considering a cubic ferromagnetic lattice with periodic boundary conditions. So every variable has, on average, is involved in 6 couplings. And this means that the ground state can be measured as -3 times the number of variables. So they considered this generic graph embedding, which is complete graph, marked in red. And they considered a heuristic algorithm for embedding, which is blue. And you can see that the name of the game is obviously to get to optimality or as close as possible. So with several iterations, they're hoping to achieve the ground state. And the heuristic optimization method outperforms the complete graph method. So what we've done is now introduce a optimal embedding method, which is shown in the light blue. And we can see that this gives a substantial gain over the heuristic method. So it should be pointed out that their paper was their paper and method was designed for a generic graph, although they applied it to a cubic lattice. In this case, we're specifically leveraging the fact it's a cubic lattice to get such high performance. So we can move from just studying D-Wave 2000Q in that example to studying Advantage. So this is the same blue curve as on the previous plot. And now we compare D-Wave 2000Q to Advantage, which is marked in orange. And we're also going to go from a ferromagnet at 10 by 10 by 10 scale to a spin glass at 18 by 18 by 18 scale. And spin glasses are random problems. The couplers are plus minus one uniformly at random. So it's interesting to look at an average over models. And here I'm presenting an average over 16 models. So we can see that now both curves again burn down to low energy over many iterations, but the Advantage processor burns down much more quickly. But the real action for us is actually when we get very close to the ground state. So what's actually happening down here in the bottom right corner of the plot is very important. And what's also important to us is moving towards more realistic notions of time rather than iteration. So let's see what happens to the plot when we do that. To measure time in this talk, I'm going to use QPU access time. So this is the time charged to the customer for access to our QPUs, and it's available in the timing information in the return object. So we can measure our time progressing in QPU access time. It includes programming time, includes the annealing time, and also the readout time. At the same time, we can try and estimate where the ground state is, looking at many solvers, including QPU solvers and classical solvers. Take that estimate and work out how far we are from that estimate relative to the distance we would expect to be with a random solution. And so when we plot this on a log scale, we can see high resolution of how far we are from the ground state. So here it's called approximation ratio, but it's also been called relative error in some of the other talks at qubits. So here we show that Advantage is much better than D-Wave 2000Q, not only in short time scales, but in long time scales. So we'll move from here to a more complicated comparison against some software solvers. So the first solver that we can compare against is Greedy, which is an open source steepest greedy descent implementation that D-Wave has as part of the Ocean Software Development Kit. If we draw one greedy sample, so we basically run downhill to a local minimum, we get the dashed line. So we achieve an energy that's better than one, so better than a random choice. but still very limited compared to what's achieved with the advantage method in Orange. If we give the greedy method 166 seconds, it can draw 16,000 samples, and you can take the best one. And this gets you as far as the teal line, which is only just below the dashed line. So greedy descent, even with extreme parallelization, is a very poor method for reaching these low energies. The advantage result is still shown in orange. And the blue curve is an annealing approximation. So the annealing method we use is also open source. It's based on D-Wave Neal, available as in Ocean SDK as well. We use a geometric schedule terminated with a quench. And we optimize for each timescale the number of reads relative to the number of sweeps so that the performance is well-tuned for all the different timescales. So it should be noted that the CPU implementation of D-Wave Neal is here measured in terms of wall clock time, whereas the orange curve is QPU access time. So there is a disparity in the way we've timed here. But if we look at the very low energies, so approximation ratios between 10 to the minus 3 and 10 to the minus 2, we can see that we are already a couple of orders of magnitude faster than D-Wave Neal. So we're confident that when we include a more realistic wall clock time here, we remain ahead of the other curve. And we're working very hard on this, I should say. So we can go beyond just looking at simulated annealing on CPU and look at a GPU implementation on a modern processor, where we exploit sub-lattice parallelism and sample parallelism. And we can do the same thing we did with the CPU implementation, which is optimize number of reads relative to number of sweeps with a geometric schedule. And then you introduce this this light blue curve. And we can see that for intermediate timescales and these more challenging approximation ratios towards the bottom of the grid, we're the D-Wave advantage, as measured in QPU access time, is still ahead of this GPU implementation of simulated annealing. So very promising results. We're competitive against all these algorithms, and we're working hard on turning this into a wall clock time result, alleviating some of the efficiencies in D-Wave Hybrid and other software elements in the process. And of course, this is only a bare bones implementation that I presented, so there's lots of room to get the QPU to work harder. So in conclusion, I've shown open source D-Wave Hybrid implementation of this very simple workflow where the QPU does almost all the results. It's competitive with simulated annealing with some tuned parameters on a couple of different platforms. We've also shown the importance of embedding correctly and also major gains from the D-Wave 2000Q generation to the Advantage generation. And so with my last few seconds, I'd just like to congratulate Giorgio Parisi on receiving the Nobel Prize yesterday in physics. Before I came to D-Wave, I was a researcher in Giorgio Parisi's group in Rome. And I came to D-Wave because I was studying large hard optimization problems. And his methods on replica symmetry breaking and understanding of spin glass models and their rich energy landscape was really what set me up for where I am now. So thanks to him and thanks to his research group. And thank you to the audience, of course.